Pisos, bienvenidos a México. Pues mi pregunta sería, ¿cómo fue la interacción entre ustedes para aterrizar la relación que tuvieron para la película? Y aparte de eso, me gustaría saber qué fue el extra que le pusieron para sus respectivos personajes, que la verdad es muy increíble la película. Gracias.
I mean, I think me and James, we got on very well, very quickly. We're both, I think, the kind of actors that like to get involved and start doing something rather than just stand around and talk about. I think what I certainly learn more by doing than I do by talking. And I think once you get on set and you realize you're on the same page, it makes everything a lot easier and a lot quicker. And a lot more fun. And in terms of the last part of your question about what we added to the characters, I mean, I think most of what was there for me was in the script, and that's the script already, and it just became about making it, I suppose, as real as possible. And I guess, I just said Paul said to me the other day, which like, hadn't really occurred to me, but I suppose we did do this, was make it feel modern and not play it like we're in a period piece and just have that sort of modern urgency to it.
Yeah, I think that Daniel and I have both got a very similar kind of approach to the work. We both, I think, wanted to make this a very energetic, very sort of the characters are sweating blood because they're doing something incredible. They're doing something that is extreme, and their performances at times and when warranted, not always, should be extreme as well. And when we had 5 days rehearsal in New York, and it was really abundant material within the first 10 minutes really, that we were kind of cut from the same cloth and that we had very much a similar idea about how we wanted to approach the work. In terms of what we added, I don't know, really, just what Daniel said. And you know, Max's inspiration when he wrote the script was the guys that created Facebook. You know, he wanted to be about two young men standing at the very limits of scientific and technological capability. And really trying to push through that wall to change the world forever. And so Dan was so right. It was a modern inspiration. Maybe that's why we did the work, you know, to kind of give it a more sort of modern energy.
Because Daniel's the busiest man in show business. But we get on really, really well, and it's so nice to be able to, I don't know, take that relationship on screen the further way, because sometimes you have to work with people and it's not even that you don't get on with them, it's just that there's nothing there. It's just that it's all about the work and then everything takes, you don't want to even have a chat, you know? And it's not that they're bad, there's nothing sort of ill between you, but Dan and I got on really well, and it's just, I think it leads on to the screen.
I think James should absolutely do a musical.
Right now, in this room. I think, there's an incredible wealth of talent in Mexican cinema. Apart from the fact that I don't speak Spanish. It would be fantastic working here. So if there's a part out there for a white that doesn't speak any Spanish, I'm in. Am I done?
But it's not
this. Thanks. In terms of musicals, I've nearly done like 2 musicals, and then for whatever reason, the scheduling conflict or we couldn't get the right sort of personnel and all that kind of stuff just falling through. But I am keen to do it. It's got to be the right thing, it's got to be done in the right way. And Pam's done fantastic. I'm glad to follow him.
With a very, very strange ending that was basically saying we were in a different location. It was really setting up a sequel. And I think me and James, when we both read it, had the same reaction. We're going, like, let's just make one good film. Let's concentrate on making a good movie first before we get too caught up in any ideas or anything else. And obviously, like, if people love it and they want to make more, then I think we both think about it. But also, I think the question in our minds is, what the hell happens next? Other than just them doing the same things all over again.
Yeah, I completely agree. It's more important to see if the desire is there from the audience is to see more. And then you can choose to find what happens to the characters. But again, yeah, Daniel's right. What's going to do? Go and do it again. Go and do it bigger, better, worse.
I don't know. Or maybe it's a different person. Maybe they can still be Frankenstein and becomes more about anyone trying to create a life. But yeah, you can say what you want. The Victorian setting of this film, because it's not originally set in the Victorian era in the book, but setting it in, particularly in England, during the Victorian era, during, more importantly, the Industrial Revolution, where machines and technology were transforming the way that people lived and really sort of accelerated us from a rural-based society to one that was city-based in a matter of decades. Kind of the same time as we're going through a technological revolution now, where our lives are being transformed in a matter of years by technology. That was happening then at a rate that's never been seen before. And the people who were making that happen were people like Victor and Igor, people who held the fire of the gods in their hands and were using it to change people's lives irrevocably, and so that they would be unrecognizable from just last year. And I think that's what's said in the Victorian era, particularly in England, does for the film. It gives it that context of adventurers in science. People who don't really know what the implications of their work are going to be, but they're doing it anyway, and they're going to change the face of the planet. And that's how they see themselves, I think.
Yeah. And in terms of like what made me want to play Igor in the film, it was really entertaining. The script, first and foremost, it made me like, you know, as Dave said, it really tears along very quickly, and it's very funny, it's got a sense of humour, which I thought was important in a film like this. And with the character of Igor, there was obviously a chance to sort of perform this cool story of this guy's journey into becoming a human being on an equal footing with everybody else, which is what he wants to be in the story, or even if he doesn't know that he wants that. And there's a sweetness to him, and there's something incredibly sweet and loyal and honest about him, which I found very charming in a world where kind of everybody has sort of greater motivations. Evil really doesn't have any of those, he just wants to live a life where he feels like he's part of society. What to talk about? Oh, your first day.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a funny story, isn't it?
Yeah. Funny. I don't know really. Is it the first day on set was the scene where we had to drain the pus out of Daniel's hump? And he came in to rehearse the night before, and I said to the props people, I was saying, I need a tube, a rubber hose, so that I can suck out the pus with my mouth. And they were like, what? And I said, no, it's okay, it will become clear tomorrow. And I don't think anybody really thought that we were going to do it. But we did it the next day, and when you get gas out of the car, and then you put it out, but you always get a little bit in your mouth, so you go, heck, and you stay the thing. And so we did that scene, and it was disgusting, and it was horrible. Which is great, because you're making a movie about Frankenstein, which is essentially a zombie. And so you've got to be kind of gross sometimes. And Daniel obviously tells the story of him walking out of the set and looking at the producer's faces, just being absolutely aghast. And being like, ah, and what the hell are these actors doing with a movie that was really good in the script? And so that was kind of like, for me, that was one of the funnest days. Because it really felt like we were kind of putting our stamp on the film and saying, this is what the script is, we know what it is, but this is what we're going to do to it. Which is sort of, I know it's kind of a bit brash and a bit sort of, I don't know, weird, but it just felt like I knew that, you know. Daniel Radcliffe is one. True modern stories. Daniel is the hardest working man I've ever worked with, or woman. And that's not just blowing smoke up his arse, that's just a great image, isn't it? He's the most professional actor I've ever come across, and I find that terrifying because he's like, what, 10 years younger than me? And that's slightly upsetting to me. That's the first thing that I noticed about Daniel. That was on day one, when he literally ran past me to get to set, and I remember thinking, Maybe there's food on set, or maybe there's maybe people have got donuts on location and he's trying to get one. But no, that's what Daniel does, and it's really admirable. And it's not just about, it's about an energized commitment to the work. And as a person outside of work, he's really conscious of his time and considerate and really annoying. Because he's so nice. It's so annoying to hear that, but it's true.
And I'm about to pretty much echo all that going back the other way, so sorry, guys, you're going to be really bored by these answers. But it is true, like everything I've heard about James before working with him, and then we got on set and it was all true, and you know, he's bold and fearless and committed to everything he does as an actor, and also like a huge amount of fun to be around between takes. And yeah, I mean it's a pleasure to know the film. I also like grew up like, because when I was on Potter, I was working with like Maggie Smith and Rich Harris and those guys. Like, I was aware that they were very famous, respected actors, but I hadn't like grown up watching a lot of their films. Whereas like I had grown up seeing James in a lot of stuff, and like really, I don't know. So I think for the first 2 weeks or so, I had to like slightly work on just being able to not be like a fan, being a bit in awe, just like being like, no, we're working together now. You can just like. We're on a little playing field and trying to put that in. But that was probably helpful for the relationship with people as well. it was a total pleasure. And one I hope you get to do again.
Yeah, definitely.
For Igor, obviously, as you say, it's not in the book. The only incarnation of Igor that I had seen previously was Marty Feldman in Young Frankenstein. So I wasn't going to try and compete with that. And in a way, I think it took a lot of the pressure off it, in a sense, like, I wasn't like, fanatically familiar with every film that's ever been made, because I was free to kind of give it my own interpretation, and I was aware that this was a take on Igor that we've not really seen before. So it seemed like that kind of seemed like permission to do whatever they would like. And I worked on it with a lady called Catherine Hunter, who's a very amazing physical actress, so I sort of worked with her for a few sessions on getting Igor's physicality right.
Yeah, I think Victor's relationship with Igor, from Victor's point of view, is all basically, to begin with anyway, based on what he thinks he can get from him. And the way that Victor sees the world is full of commodities or obstacles that will either help him or hinder him from getting what he wants and what he wants to do, which is to become the creator of life. He kind of essentially wants to become God in a way. So he sees Igor as a tool that he can use and at times horribly abuse, I think. But you can't spend that much time with somebody and rely that much on somebody without letting them in and without developing respect or love or affection for them. And what ends up happening to Victor is that he ultimately, against his wishes really, makes the only friend, his best friend, the only friend that he's ever really had. And the closest thing he's got to somebody that he shares true love with. Hollywood Walk of Fame.
I really want to direct at some point, and I would like to go ahead and direct, because that's definitely a dream still. And in terms of the challenge, I suppose it was like, you know, these are very heightened situations, and you know, this is stuff that doesn't and can't really happen. So you're in a slightly fantastical world, and I think the challenge in that is always making it feel as real and as close to the world we live in as we can.
For me, the challenge with playing Victor was really to kind of was to fully express and live in his sort of manic, hyperactive state. But at the same time, not push the audience away too much with behaviour that is so alien that they can't relate to it. So try and go for that in the extreme, but still let the audience in and have moments of pathos and compassion where the audience can really understand him as somebody like them, and then kick him in the teeth and want to do something crazy again.
All the stuff and allowed me to play more roles than just Harry, which is fantastic. the star essentially to me means that, like, no matter how badly things go from here, I always have that. there's some comfort and security in that. But I'm very excited about the future. You know, I'm in a position which very few actors, particularly actors of my age, are, where you have a lot of say over what you want to do and a lot of control in your career. And you don't have to do something unless you love it and are excited by it. I'm very excited about just continuing, hopefully, on that path and making more weird, cool movies like this one.
They both look like me, which is very, very similar, actually. They are. I think that in lots of ways, especially from Days of Future Past and Charles in that particular film, there was a sort of mental imbalance to Charles that is also clearly evident, massively evident in Victor. Where they are similar is that I think they both hold so much dangerous information. They're both in charge of something that is potentially explosive, and that they live with that pressure every single day of their lives. And whereas Charles is more, where they're different, is that Charles is a responsible man who sees that as a heavy burden, whereas Victor relishes it and sees it as like a firework display. You can't wait for, you know, fireworks night where you can go crazy and make all nice colours in the sky. That's it. That's poetic. They are similar in lots of ways, but very, very different in lots of ways. If, like, Victor's like the evil twin brother of somebody like Charles, you know what I mean? He's like Charles on a really bad day. Which I do actually think there is a comic book version of, like, an evil version of Charles, which I would love to play.